Hey, I see you there, watching this channel and all the others like it, thinking, that stuff's really cool, but I could never do that. Lurking. You're a lurker. Cardinal sin in the creative arts. What's your constraint? Can't get hold of XPS foam in your part of the world. Can't get your hands on double corrugated cardboard or foam board or graphics medium chipboard. Can't spray paint because you live in an apartment. You're on limited means. You're generally overwhelmed or intimidated by what it takes to actually get started up. Whatever the case, I am here to help you get over the hump. Today I have a series of small rapid-fire projects that you can complete in a day to spruce up your tabletop role-playing game, such as Dungeons & Dragons. So let's start with the bare essentials. You're a dungeon master, you want to show a room of a dungeon on the table to your players to give a tactical feel. Let's make some dungeon walls. Look at this! It's Jenga! Or off-brand Jenga. It's not Jenga. Think I found this at the dollar store for like 8 bucks. It was definitely less than 10. Wooden blocks. Nice and solid, good weight to them. These'll work. Then food box cardstock, like cereal box or anything that dry foods usually come in. That gauge of cardstock is what we're after. I'm going to cut a few strips, about a centimeter wide, maybe a little less. Doing it freehand, no ruler, I want it to be slightly wavy. And then chopping up lots and lots of bricks, varying the size, some big, some small. Good set of kitchen shears should be able to chop through a whole bunch of them at once. And this is white PVA glue. Elmer's is one of the most popular brands in my neck of the woods, but anything that says white PVA glue will work. I'm going to paint some on the wooden block, and it's a healthy amount because that wood is going to drink it in. This is going to dry in like 10 minutes very quickly, so you got to work fast, and don't be afraid to slather a little bit of glue on there. Using some tweezers or any other fine pointed tool, you sort of dip it in the white glue, then go tap one of those cardstock bricks and then bring it over and stick it on. You can work very quickly once you get in a groove with this. It takes just a minute to get the technique going. Here's an example where I'm not laying it out in 3 rows. I ended up not doing that for my walls, but if you like that look, go for it. Now it's time to paint, and I would spray paint these black, but again, I'm assuming you don't have spray paint. We're gonna use acrylic craft paint. Now paintbrushes. You can find assorted sets like this at your crafting store for very little money. Look at this, 8 bucks for a huge variety set. This is definitely good enough to get you started. And paints, don't buy expensive paints. Find the ones that are in bottles like this. This particular brand I'm showing you is $2 for this bottle, but they can be as cheap as 70 cents a piece. Cheap acrylic craft paints. So to base up this wall, I'm going to get the brush very wet. I dip it in my cup of water, then go directly to the paint and then to the piece. And that'll all mix at the moment it hits and sort of dilute it down so that the black gets on all the edges of those cardstock bricks. You want as little of that showing as possible. You want a nice solid black base coat. And get yourself 2 shades of gray. A gray and a dark gray. That's literally what these are called. This brand, CraftSmart, these were, I think, 65 cents a piece. Very, very cheap. And we're going to do some dry brushing. Dry brushing is where you put some paint on the brush and then you work most of it right back off onto some paper like this. And then you can quickly and with fairly low pressure swipe at the piece and you'll notice that all of the raised details and all the edges are going to catch those bristles and take that little bit of paint that's on them and leave everything else with the undercoat. The net effect here is a quick and dirty gray stone block. It might take you 1 or 2 sides to get the knack for exactly how much paint to have on the brush and how much pressure to use as you're swiping at it, but it's easy to master within seconds. Also get yourself a good solid rich brown. We're going to be using it and reusing it. Pick out a few blocks on each side of the wall, maybe 3 or 4, and just paint them with solid brown. Don't worry if it's an incomplete coat and you can sort of see through. It's perfectly fine. Doesn't have to look great. Just do one coat. Alright, so we've dry brushed with dark gray, we've painted on some brown on some of the bricks, now we're going to go to that normal gray and do more dry brushing. This with even less paint on the brush and even less pressure. And there, what you see is it just pops the thing to life, it ties all of the undercolors together, And with three very easy steps, you got a stylish looking stone block dungeon wall. Now we're going to need a floor for the dungeon. This, if you've seen any sort of packaging box, you've seen this. This is single corrugated cardboard. It's got that fluting in the middle. Start hoarding this if you want to get into crafting. This is great stuff. I'm going to cut two identical squares as big as I can. I think these were 10 inches, but if you can go bigger, go bigger. Anyway, two identical squares, and then rotate one of them 90 degrees so that the direction of that fluting is like this. One's going one way, one's going the other. This is going to help with strength and anti-warping. Using hot glue to attach them together. You could use white glue as well, like we did earlier, just paint it all over, but hot glue is really quick and I prefer it for that reason. For those ugly exposed corrugated edges, if you want, if it bothers you, fill it in with some hot glue. Just squeeze some on there and then use the nozzle to tease it and spread it out a bit. At this point, I base coated it with black. I don't remember why I did that. You don't have to do this yet. It doesn't hurt, but we still have to put the blocks on, so let's go and do that. Exactly like we did the walls, cutting out a whole bunch of that food box cardstock bricks, and then painting on some white glue and attaching them with tweezers. Do a little bit at a time, because again, white glue will start to set and dry in about 10 minutes. So I'm working in these maybe 2x2 inch square areas at a time. And again, this is a large area to cover, but it only took me, 45 minutes to an hour to do this entire giant square. Once you get in a groove with the tweezers, it really helps. Dip them in the white glue, go get a brick. Dip them in the white glue, go get a brick. And now, once that's all bone dry, half hour later, base coat with black, just like we did the walls. After that, it's the heavy dry brush with the dark gray, just like the walls, but then I'm gonna stop. Notice that there's a bit of contrast now between the floor and the walls. If you did that brown and then the gray dry brush, they would really start to overwhelm the eye. I find that having the floor be more subtle is helpful, so don't bother. Just stop here. You base coat it black, you give it a good dry brush with the dark gray. At this point, you probably notice it rocks pretty bad. This whole base has been warped. That's typical when you're using materials like cardboard. The solution? Paint some white PVA glue on the bottom. Now I went a little heavier here than I should have, so you can see how thick it is. You can just barely see through the white to the brown cardboard underneath. Normally that's about good enough, but I kind of overcorrected. You get used to this after one or two projects. Don't overthink it, just paint a smooth layer of white glue on the bottom, then set it aside for 24 hours to fully dry. And I mean that, 24 hours. Here it is after 15 minutes. The cardboard's already starting to absorb it. You can see some spots coming through. And in fact, you'll notice that the warping is probably getting even worse in the direction that it was. Not good, right? Here it is about 3 hours later, perfectly dry to the touch, but warped even worse than when I started. Strange, right? But this is where it comes in. You wait a full 24 hours for that glue to fully seep in and fully cure. And what happens? You end up with a rock solid, perfectly flat tile. So, this is universally true. If you ever have warping issues, paint a nice healthy coat of white PVA glue on the bottom and spread it out and leave it there upside down for a solid 24 hours. What good is a dungeon without doors? Now I have here some popsicle sticks, sometimes called crafting sticks. You can get those from any crafting store. If you drink coffee, you've probably seen coffee stirrers in the grocery aisle. Get some of those. So I'm going to make some with each, make thicker doors, chunkier, and make some with the coffee stirrers. The technique is identical. You lay a few of them together, you chop a piece down to length to go across them, and hot glue it on. Piece of cake. Then we'll cut away the excess. And I recommend trying to make your doors 1 inch wide and 2 inches tall. Those cross members go on each side of the door. And here you go, I'm going to make another one, this with the coffee stirrers, the much thinner ones. Cutting this wood with my knife as opposed to a saw or some other tool, because again, I am trying to minimize the amount of materials and tools that you'll have to buy. Again, we'll cover all of that at the end. So here they are, side by side. Both look fine in their own way. Go with whatever you like. Now, since these are already wood, we don't have to do too much. We're going back to that brown that we used earlier, mixing in a little bit of black, and then watering this down fairly heavily to get a nice darker brown that's watered down. And this basically is going to act like a wood stain almost. I'm just going to paint it on here, sort of spread it out. It's going to soak in really quickly, and voila, you've got a decent looking wood instantly. Yes. Now go to your local hardware store. I guarantee they'll have washers. This pack was $7 for 25 of them. And you want to try and find ones that are 1 inch in diameter with the smallest hole possible. That's what I've found here. And I'm simply going to hot glue it to the washer. It's going to cool almost instantly because metal is a very good heat sink. And now I've got a great base for my door. It's not going to tip over. Normally, with metals and plastics, you want to spray prime it before you paint it. Acrylic paint will not stick to metal. It'll rub right off. But we're not using spray paints in this video, so we use a poor man's primer. Again, white PVA glue. Yep, paint a thick coat of white PVA glue on that washer. Set it aside for a few hours to dry. As expected, it dries clear. Give a solid base coat of black, and if you want this to sort of blend in and match your dungeon floor, give it a dry brush with that same dark gray. I personally don't care about door pulls or handles, but if you do, here's an idea. Take a paper clip, bend it into a loop, and then attach it with a little bit of white glue. If you want those cross members to be like banded iron, then invest, it's probably a dollar, for a good metallic paint like a gunmetal or pewter or silver, and just paint them that color. Now, what good is any dungeon on the table without miniatures? I'm going to show you how to make some free cardstock miniatures. I'm using Microsoft Word for this, but you could use any word processor or image editing software that you're comfortable with. Whatever you got going on is going to work fine. The principle is exactly the same. We start out making a rectangle, and I'm going to make this 1.1 inches high, or 28 millimeters. In case you didn't know, that's the industry standard for miniatures from ground level to eye level, 28 millimeters for a standard human. Width doesn't matter. Coloring it black, that's going to be the gauge to help us scale our images correctly. Now on to Google image search. D&D fighter. Let's find just a standard soldier, something to do as a good humanoid example. This looks like a good one. I'm going to give that a right click and a copy, and then paste it into Word or whatever software you're using. Nice. And then in the case of Word, I'm going to change the text wrapping to in front of text. This will treat it as a free-floating image that I can move and size at will without any weirdness of it being tied to the cursor. I'm going to scale it down so that the eyes are at the top of that gauge and the feet are at the bottom. Again, not the top of the head or the top of the feature. Look at where the eyes are on the creature. Bottom of the feet to eye level should be 28 millimeters. Then I pull that over to the side. Give it a border to help me cut it out later on, and then duplicate it, then mirror it vertically. And there we go. I could move these two jointly and make copies of them, make a whole blister sheet of soldiers. Maybe this is a standard guard model and I want to make a whole bunch of them. Let's go find a standard monster. Back to Google image search, D&D goblin. And this looks like a good one. We'll give that the old copy and paste, size it down, and same thing. Give it a black border, duplicate it, and mirror it. Now I'm mirroring this one horizontally. It really doesn't matter. You can do it vertical or horizontal. It's whatever's most economical to fit the most of them on a page that you can. So we go ahead and print these up. And to actually build and use them is going to be pretty streamlined because, again, we made copies of them all in a row, so they share that mirror line. We fold along the mirror line exactly, and then back to food box cardstock. I'm using a glue stick here. You could absolutely use white PVA glue and just paint on a very, very thin layer. It'd be just as easy, but I like to use glue stick for this. So, stick it to that food box cardstock. You may want to cut a fresh straight edge before you do that. And then this is optional. This is packing tape. Totally optional. I like to have a little bit of gloss to my miniatures, so Just pull a long piece and then attach it on both sides. Totally optional, don't have to do that. Then just cut it out, cut along the lines, and add a little curve along the top if you like to. Easy peasy, done and done. You know, the most frequent question I get asked is, what do I do with large monsters, the kind that you would mount on a 2-inch base? My answer is, large monsters, and really anything that's not a medium humanoid, there's so much variability in what those creatures could be. What I do is just put it in your image editing software next to your humanoid fighter and scale it until it looks right. That's it. Let's pull those washers back out, and we're going to mount the miniatures on the washers. Just a thin bead of hot glue along the bottom edge and stick it on. If you like, use that poor man's primer, white PVA glue, and then paint it jet black. Here's a few of them finished in a row. Very nice. So you can see, you have at your fingertips an infinite array of cardstock miniatures thanks to Google Image Search. Lastly, let's try a simple cottage. We're going to go back to single corrugated cardboard and cut out the pieces to make the basic form of a house. Just two rectangles and then the two other ends. Use a ruler, make it all match up. It ain't rocket science. And hot glue it together. Going back to our wood products, popsicle sticks or coffee stirrers, whatever you were using. We'll cut some lengths and just start trimming out the cottage. Cover up those ugly corners, maybe put on some cross members, some diagonal stuff, whatever you want. Hit Google Image Search, look for some inspirational images for like medieval inn, whatever. I'm keeping it simple for the purposes of this tutorial today. You also may find that the building is a little bit flexy or unstable. Put in a cross member. Just cut something to length and slather it in hot glue. How good the inside looks does not matter. Shingles. Do not overthink shingles. In my humble opinion, people spend way too much time on shingles for their structures. Here's what I do. Take that food box cardstock, cut a strip that's about 3/4 inch wide, and then start nipping like 2/3 of the way through, like you see me doing here. And the width of each shingle varies. Make some of them real thin, make some real thick. So you get this, partially cut through the strip all the way down. Then take your scissors and start nicking away, I don't know, 1, maybe 2 millimeters of every few shingles, every 4 or 5 shingles. Make it random, mix it up. And what you'll find is, with all this randomness, as you start stacking up the layers of shingles, it's going to be a very convincing effect. Hot glue them onto the roof, overlapping, beginning with the bottom row, like this. And for the roof cap, just overlap a few squares, like this. 15 minutes and the roof is shingled. Now get yourself a beige or an ivory, an off-white, it really doesn't matter, just something like that, and base coat all your walls with it. You will find that with these lighter colors, you need to do 2 coats. So after the first one dries, it's going to look terrible. It's going to look splotchy and streaky. That's normal. It is actually the standard that you generally should do 2 coats of whatever you're painting. Some more single corrugated, giving this the dungeon wall treatment. I'm not going to go through that again. We did it before. Painting it up the same way. Now we're going to prepare a wash. For the purpose of this video, a wash is simply a lot of water with a little bit of paint, as opposed to a lot of paint that's slightly watered down. This is mostly water, and I am doing a little bit of black and a little bit of brown to get a nice burnt umber here, and it's heavily, heavily watered down, and I'm going to slather the wall with it. Now, you can see that's a little bit rich, and I realize that, so I go right to my water cup and back and hit the piece with the brush and start slurrying it around on there to mix it around and thin it out in real time. Washes dry much subtler than they look when they're wet. Right now, it probably looks like, you know, very, very brown, but once it dries, it is going to be lightened up quite a bit. It's just the nature of the way that the pigment works. For the roof shingles, I'm hitting it also with that wash, although I did add a little more paint. It's a little more thickened up, but still fairly diluted. I'm not too worried about a splotchy finish, because in this case, I think it will actually help. It'll give a little bit of character, dimension to those shingles. While that's drying, let's attach these cobblestone skirts. just going to hot glue them on. They've been painted up like the dungeon wall. The walls are dried, as you can see, and we got a nice stucco sort of, I don't know, whatever, medieval look. And then I'm hot gluing on these skirts. Here's the roof all dry. Looks terribly splotchy, as you'd expect, because it was heavily watered down paint. I don't even care. I'm moving on. I'm taking that milk chocolatey brown right out of the bottle, and I am dry brushing with it. Gonna dry brush these shingles. If you want a different colored roof, just pick two other colors. If you want a blue roof, do dark blue and then dry brush with a light blue. Keep it simple. Notice that the fibrous texture of those shingles is doing a lot of work for you. This is key. I've been gluing the shiny side of this food box cardstock down pretty much the entire video. I think the entire video. That was my intent, at least. You want the brown papery side up, because that fibrous texture will do a lot of work for you. And here, while you have some mixed up wash, play around a little bit. Put some dabs on there, smear it with your finger, just work on aging. This is your first project. Practice. Figure out what works and what doesn't. That's what I'm doing. Let's set all this up and look at it in context. We'll lay down our base mat for the dungeon, and then just start placing walls. So the idea is you're going to set up a very simple combat encounter for your players. Their first level, it's a goblin ambush, whatever. Put a couple doors down, throw in the goblins. The players open the door and they come through, and now it's time for a fight. And you can use this terrain to help you gauge distances and position. It's also just fun to look at, and it was pretty fun to make. With those doors and miniatures being bottom heavy, very bottom heavy because of the washer, they're pretty much guaranteed never to incidentally tip over. Here's a look at our cottage. This is my 15-minute rapid build. Sure, it doesn't look realistic, and some of the colors clash. I don't really like how orangey that brown is, but can always repaint it later. And besides, the point of your first project is not to get your ultimate mind's eye result. You're not going to get that on your first attempt at crafting, I guarantee it. But as you iterate and find out what works for you and what you think your style is, you will get a cottage that looks like you think a cottage should look. Get out some green felt or even a green sheet of construction paper. We'll put down the cottage and then build like a yard around it, reusing those dungeon walls for a different purpose, right? Maybe this is a hunter's lodge, and out in the front yard, they're practicing right now. You could go craft a bullseye, set it in there, and set a scene. Maybe the goblins will ambush these hunters and the party is in the building or something. There's a lot you can do with just a few pieces like this. Let's do a quick tally and total of everything that we've used. Hot glue gun. I'm saying $10 for a gun and hot glue. I'm using a SureBonder, but you can definitely find a serviceable $5 model at your crafting store. Assorted paint brushes, $8. Acrylic paints, at most $10. A good 25mm retractable Ulfa knife, $15. Metal ruler, 16 to 18 inches, $8. Jenga ripoff, at most $10. 1-inch metal washers, $7. Bottle of white PVA glue, $8. Coffee stirrers or popsicle sticks, $5. Corrugated cardboard, presumed free. Food box cardstock, presumed free. Printer paper, presumed free. Grand total, $81 plus tax. Use Google to translate to your currency. And remember, almost all of this is startup cost, not recurring. So to do more projects, you don't have to spend it again. So if you're now brand new but about to get started to making stuff to enhance your tabletop gaming, great. I have a backlog of videos and there's lots of other YouTubers like me. Also find us on Facebook, the Tabletop Crafters Guild, almost 40,000 members strong. Dig in, have fun, make things, and play games.